Right, thanks for coming in. We'll just wait a few seconds, see if a few more people have any questions, and then we'll just run through briefly what we're doing on Wikipedia.
Anyone else coming in to see or listen to the lecture on the Wiki project? Ask your questions about the Wiki project.
Okay, right, we'll get going. Thanks for coming. Please come in and join us. So, just a quick session really, explaining what the purpose of the project is. Has anyone got any previous knowledge about editing on Wikipedia? Tiny bit. Okay. I thought basically we'd just run through some of the principles of Wikipedia, what the current status is of the project, and then talk briefly about what people could do and why they want to do it, and then a couple of questions, and then obviously, you know, see the rest of the show, and any further questions you can obviously come and see us on the stand. So Wikipedia, as you may or may not know, is built on five pillars. Thank you, please come in and join us. We've just started. Built on the five pillars of Wikipedia, which basically, the first one, it's an encyclopedia, so it's not promotional, it's not a directory of things, it's a place where you go to look up information as you would do a paper encyclopedia. The second one is that the content is written in a neutral manner, and also, please come in and join us, is that it's verifiable. So although you or I might know that something's true, just adding that to a Wikipedia entry isn't necessarily good enough, because someone could read it and they could say, well, how do I know that it's true? Just because it's there, it might not be true. So the idea of having it verifiable is that if some information is included, particularly if it could be contested by someone, there's a little citation which, you know, is bit of experience, that little links at the bottom saying where that information can be cross-referenced to. The third one is that it's free to edit, use, modify and distribute. Now, this is obviously important in places of the world where people haven't got access to information outside of the RISC OS world. So they can go to the Wikipedia, get information without having to pay to buy books if they haven't got any money. Please come in and join us. And anyone can, you know, you don't have to pay to edit it. If you want to print, please come in and join us if you like. If you want to produce any printed material based on Wikipedia content, that's also free. All you have to do is credit the original authors. That applies to the majority of free photographs as well. And then the other thing, as editors, there's a lot of respect between editors. And things are progressed through discussion and consensus. So although people can get a bit heated in some subject areas, not so much in the RISC OS area, but there can be heated discussions, and editors have to have respect for one another, otherwise they'll have their editing privileges withdrawn until there's more discussion about that. And finally, all of these sort of rules and policies and guidelines, they're not carved in stone, so although say that things have to be verifiable, some things it is just common sense. You're not going to say it needs to be verified that things fall to the ground under gravity. I mean, it probably is verified, just an example. Please come in and join us. You can come and sit down at the front if you wish. Okay. So that's the sort of five pillars of Wikipedia. Has anyone got any questions on that, or anything that did you want to get out of this that you might miss the beginning?
Let's carry on. I don't want to disturb you. Make your life more difficult.
Okay. So the current status of the project, the RISC OS Wiki project works as a task force underneath the computing project. There are obviously a lot of articles, a lot of subject matter in the encyclopedia, and this can be categorised into different classified, if you like. Certain articles will relate to certain things. So an article about this hotel, you'd say, well, that's related to architecture and the town of Feltham, etc., etc. So computing articles have their own projects so that people who are interested in that can see which articles are part of it and they can work on them to improve them. And then as a sub-level, then we have RISC OS articles, we've got various things for other platforms as well. Now, there's been some categorisation done so that we can identify which articles are relevant to RISC OS. Please come in and join us and take a seat. And we have about 140 articles which have been identified as being relevant to the project. So it's easy to find out what subject matter is covered and what is missing, which we weren't able to do before, it was just all lumped in with a big computing project. And within those classifications, we've allocated an importance to things. We've got top importance articles, which obviously concern the operating system itself. We have high importance, which is well regarded companies and hardware platforms, that sort of thing. And then as you go down, you've got mid importance and low importance, which will be some of the various pieces of software and maybe little books, that sort of thing, which perhaps not everyone knows about, but they're still relevant. So really, this is just a means to sort of introduce people to it. If anyone wants to come and sign up for an account, that can be done on our desk outside. That's obviously free. We've got a few little stickers and various other bits of information that we can pick up there. So if anyone's got any questions about creating articles or adding information to articles or what you do about sources, thank you. Then over to you if you've got any questions really about what we're doing and why we should do it. No? Yes? Sorry. Yeah, please.
There aren't any questions. Could you just give me a quick rundown on the beginning, which presumably tells you all about what you're doing? That would help. I mean,
sorry. No, that's fine. No problem. Just briefly, apologies to the rest of you. It was, thank you very much for that. The beginning really was just the five pillars of the encyclopedia, which are that it's an encyclopedia, it's not used to be used for promotion, or it's not a directory of like a list of things, not primarily anyway. Second thing is the content is to be neutral and verifiable. It's free to edit, use, modify and distribute, and then you've got this issue of respect between editors and all these policies and everything. They're not written in stone, they're sort of discussed and developed through consensus. That was the beginning.
Oh, thank you, that's helpful.
Okay. So, yes, you had something.
I was going to ask, if you've got an overhead projector, can you demonstrate on there what you're talking about so I can see it visually?
I have done that previously. I haven't brought it today. Well, I mean, I have got a laptop out, but the reason I didn't bring it in here, because previously when I've done that, I sort of thought, well, I'm here clicking on the screen and I'm not looking at you guys sat down. And I didn't think it was necessarily going to be very helpful, so rather than me spend a couple of minutes now and bring it in, if you've got some time afterwards, would you mind just popping over and I can sort of show you one-to-one there?
What's this about accounts? Account?
Well, if you want to, if you read Wikipedia, it's obviously a website, there's no account needed. If you want to edit, you don't have to have an account. You can edit anonymously based on your IP address. If you see an error, even a typo or a large error, anyone can just click on edit, and unless it's protected, a page, then you can amend things. If you register for an account, then all your edits, regardless of where you're logged in, they're allocated to you, rather than being your IP address. Accounts can still be anonymous. Some subject areas, it's obviously very important in some parts of the world to be able to edit anonymously, where various governments like to control what people are doing. So you can have anonymous accounts. If you've got an account with a username, then you've got a record of all the edits that you've done. If any other editors would like to see your previous edits, if they think, for example, someone is adding some information which isn't neutral and they're trying to promote something, they'll have a bit of a history. So it works both ways, really. That's why people have accounts.
Yeah.
Does that answer your question, or not really? Yes, yeah, sorry, it's a username, yes. A screen name, a pseudonym, yeah, that's right. Yeah, I mean, it's probably already Joe Blogs, but yeah, any name, really.
I don't tell you who he is.
Doesn't have to.
I have
an account. Yeah, I mean, people sometimes want to edit in other areas that they might want linked into them personally, you know, it's kind of private stuff that they think needs updating, but they don't want, you know, their next-door neighbour to know for any reason. You know, we've all got a right to privacy, so I think that's probably the basis of it. Yes. I haven't got a list, but there will be some, well, articles on some software that we all use. I mean, I don't think there's anything about ChangeFSI, for example, that sort of springs to mind. There is something about NetServe, we've obviously got the operating system. There are small articles on pieces of software such as Artworks. I think we're missing Impression, which I'll probably have a chat with Richard about later. I mean, if you've been to Wikipedia and looked for an article on something, has anyone thought, oh, well, why isn't that there? How would I create it? Is that a question that people might want an answer to? Right. Well, sometimes, sorry, I will come back. If people think that there should be an article, you can go in and edit it, and you can put what's a wiki link, which is essentially a hyperlink to an article that doesn't exist but could do, and that will come up as red if the article doesn't exist. Sometimes someone will create an article and link to it, and it'll obviously be a blue link like the rest of the links, but if it hasn't been created correctly and people think it's a load of nonsense, it can then get deleted, so it will appear as a red link. If you click on a red link, it's possible to create your own article, but it's probably better to go through another project all about article creation so that other editors can advise you and look at it. So there's a way to do that as well. Sorry, did you have another question there?
Yes, I've used Wikipedia quite a lot and told students to use it a great deal. But one of the things that in science, for instance, that makes it a little bit difficult for students is they go from one part of, say, chemistry to another part of chemistry. Often there are different sum symbols used for the same quantities, and this really is puzzling for them. I'm just wondering whether that's been changed since I was last teaching.
So which sort of symbols is it you're talking about?
Mathematical symbols,
right.
Essentially. I find it hard. I think it's hard to make things like this consistent in something like video. And I wouldn't like to say it was the thing that made it worthless, but it does warrant a little bit of extra problem for students, you know, because the definitions of symbols could be the same thing it's talking about, but it's different in a different different part of the same.
Right. Well, what anyone could do, students or anyone, is change them so that they are consistent. And there is a manual of style which should have the sort of accepted norms. Unfortunately, you might find that there's a bit of a choice, but there is a manual of style there which editors can work to, and when they make a change, they can just put, there's an edit summary, so you can summarise what you're doing and why you're doing. You can say, you know, in accordance with this bit of the manual style, that's why I'm changing that. But obviously, if the articles which don't conform are sort of predate the manual style and they haven't had enough editing activity, then they will still need updating, which is what editors are there to do, really.
I never told students that they could do that, and I've never got around to find the time to do it myself. But it is something that is more of a problem in your case than it would be in a different kind of system that would be solved.
Yeah, but yeah, it's it's not insurmountable, it's just a case of getting on it and doing it really, yeah.
But it is a tremendous thing for Wiki students to know about it in spite of that.
Yeah, it's often a first point of call, although it, you can't rely on everything unless you follow through the references, but in terms of summary, yeah, it can be good. So, yes. Yes, they could do. Often, depending how complicated the subject was, there might be a little summary or it might actually be a link to an article defining it. So yeah, things could do that. And if there's an article which is considered to be good, because as well as the importance, there are ratings for articles on the quality. So that's accessible by clicking on the discussion page as opposed to the article page. You can see what rating you are. So if you find a good quality article and see how that's written and linked to, then that sort of style can then be used on other articles as a starting point. So you joined us late. Did you have anything in particular? Any questions? I think we're a bit late. Yeah. We just sort of run through a bit about the encyclopedia and what we're doing really.
How long does it take generally for that to be spotted and deleted or edited? Is it just reliable to somebody go in there who knows that it's a load of rubbish taken?
It would depend how the incorrect information arrives there. If it was put there by a new editor, a new account, a new username, or a completely anonymous IP address only, those sorts of changes would probably, they'd be listed in the recent changes things, which editors control the recent changes, and that it would probably be classed as vandalism. If when they looked at it and they saw this is a new account and that looks a little bit spurious, they've changed this, they haven't said why they've changed it, there might not be a decent edit summary, it might just sound a bit implausible, so someone then might revert that if they thought it wasn't right, and that might then drop a note in their talk page saying, you know, this has been reverted because there was no source cited, go to the article page and discuss it. If it was an editor who did have an account, then and they just felt like having a laugh because they were in a bad mood that day or something, then I'd say it would be less likely to get spotted immediately. The other thing is obviously how often these articles get watched by editors. And there were God knows how many articles, hundreds of thousands or probably millions. People do have their sort of pet topic areas where they will keep an eye on things. But if it's kind of off the radar, then it would stand less chance of...
The problem is because most things, before they're released to the general public, appear reviewed and then released, but probably it's the other way around. It's released and then everybody looks at it and goes, you're talking rubbish, but by which time people have read it and take it as gospel, which is a big problem with the internet.
Yeah, I mean, it's a problem with journalism as well, with journalists using Wikipedia as a sort of research base, and rather than just using it as a starting point and then saying, oh, okay, I'll look at this, they're kind of pushed for time and their editor's probably down on them saying, where's this piece? And it's a bit of a copy and paste job, and it ends up then being printed or published elsewhere on the internet as a fact, and it can be based on incorrect facts. So that is a problem. I don't think there's a great answer for that.
Just generally, really, people accept what comes up on the internet as fact.
Well, that's a question of education, really, and you know, kids in school should be encouraged to be sceptical about things and do a bit of their own research rather than just believing what they read.
I'm sceptical people around, and the stuff my wife comes out with is spread on the internet. And then you have to slap her around the back of the head saying you're talking rubbish.
Yes.
My girlfriend's at university, she's actually
banned by the people who work at the university. Oh, right. But how can they enforce that ban?
Bristol University have banned the use of Wikipedia as part of the research. They have used research in your thesis. You've got to have reference everything you put in.
No, but there's nothing wrong with referencing the sources which Wikipedia references. Yeah. Well, that's interesting because I live in Bristol and I know another editor in Bristol who works at the university, and he is a Wikipedia editor and he's a sort of ambassador with some sort of group JISC, I forget what it stands for. Anyway, it's linked to promoting academics to both contribute to Wikipedia and value it as a resource. So while it would be a bit foolish to say, yeah, of course you can cite Wikipedia, because obviously it's wrong, using it as a starting point, there's nothing wrong.
Well, they're
arms twisting.
Yes, the first question, Mr. Lepere, my experience with students is that this business of wrong, inconsistent definitions of quantities is much more important than the possibility of big mistakes and silliness in the stuff. But that only applies to science, I'm not an expert. It might be quite different in another subject.
The science, my experience of looking at it, the science piece, because science and academics are used to doing this properly and referencing again. Most of it's right. They're used to it.
Yeah, that's right.
It's the pseudoscience, the voodoo stuff that I talk about on viruses. That's where it all goes. You're thinking, you're talking out your bottom there.
Well, there are.
Usually, when the science is wrong, it's accidental from somewhere else.
Yeah.
I mean, if the pseudoscience sort of thing, those articles, there have been endless discussions between Wikipedia editors and administrators and the arbitration committee and all sorts of things, whereby I think the Scientologists were editing their own article and using it for promotional purposes, and there's a subject ban on that being done, and various editors do get banned for these sorts of high-profile things. And I mean, any alternative medicine article would need to be written from a neutral point of view and say, this is what the practitioners believe and the training, various training bodies. However, this has been questioned by scientists as well, and both sides should be in the encyclopedia. I mean, it's not always the case, but that's what editors are trying to do in those sorts of subject areas. Yeah.
If I wrote a program and pushed it out there, could I try some of that? That seems like promoting another.
Well, a couple of things. You could just write an article on it. You'd be advised to declare your conflict of interest and obviously write it from a neutral point of view based on the facts. The second thing really is whether it would be deemed notable under all the policies. If it was a piece of software, you just wrote it and you put an article on Wikipedia with no references, then it probably wouldn't last. However, if you wrote a piece of software, it was reviewed in sort of, two or three other places, and you wrote an article and said, well, this is my piece of software, however, I think it deserves an article, here's my draft, there's really no reason why it shouldn't be included.
As an editing controller, is there some body that defines who can edit in that overall sense of they remove valuable or?
There's a bit of a control. Unless you have an account, you can't edit certain pages which are used a lot. So there are a lot of what they call them transcluded templates. So if you messed up something like that, which was used on lots of other pages as, well, like a little box stating information about something, like a biography, you'd have a little box with a photo. If that template was edited, it would obviously disrupt the rest of the encyclopedia. So unless you've got an account and you've been registered for a certain amount of time and performed a certain number of edits, then you wouldn't be able to edit those sorts of things. Even the higher visibility ones can only be edited by an administrator, because there is a potential for vandalism there. And in terms of editorial control, you're asking that as well.
Well, yes, in terms of saying if you're out an article and put it in there, you're allowed to do that. How is it vetted and removed and it's completely wrong?
If it was just edited, created straight from the red link I mentioned earlier, so you go to the red link, there's nothing there, it says you can create this article, you click create, you type in a lot of stuff, that wouldn't necessarily be vetted unless it was picked up by one of the new page patrollers. So all the new pages are listed and people can click on them and say, well, I wonder what that is, and they've probably got a lot of experience of seeing promotional articles being created and not being created from a neutral point of view, and they might deal with it and flag it for deletion. If it was a copyright violation, just a straight copy and paste from somewhere, unless there was a link demonstrating that there was permission to reproduce the text, it would be deleted. The other thing is, if you created it through the Articles for Creation project, then it wouldn't move to the main encyclopedia until other editors had looked at it. So though it might not be in a great shape, it would be better than if you'd just done it, you know, having no editing experience. So it would get looked at and it would be started as a draft, and they'd say, you know, we're not happy with this submission, have a look at this, have a look at that, and then you go back and edit that, and then it would then get moved over.
And how do people become these high-grade
editors? Well, everyone is equal, but it is based on the experience you've got. So if you've edited a lot of articles and you've demonstrated a knowledge of how the encyclopedia works, the various policies which are in place, then if you've got an opinion about the content of the article, you've obviously got more background information to base that on. But there's no reason why anyone can't just come in and say, well, you know, I've been reading Wikipedia for 10 years, I've never edited it. You know, that's a load of crap. This needs to be changed. And in terms of the respect between editors I talked about, editors are always supposed to assume good faith and not assume that someone's just, you know, creating a storm in the teacup and creating a load of fuss about nothing. And then the other thing for editorial control is, just once it's out there and it's in the main encyclopedia, particularly if it's linked to from other topics, then it will get more page views and other editors will look at it and they'll just go on and change it, and the articles evolve in that manner, really. I believe the servers are in the States, so someone correct me if I'm wrong. They're mirrored in various places in case there are problems and they go down, but yeah, it is obviously a huge amount of data. It's primarily funded by volunteers, so as well as the volunteer editors, they accept donations from anyone. There are the various chapters for different countries, so we've got Wikimedia UK here, and they take donations from people. I don't know if they have any corporate donors, I've no idea about that, but there's probably some sort of payment in kind in terms of loans of premises and stuff, I don't know, but they have an income from donations as far as I understand, and then some of that money is used to pay the overall Wikimedia organisation, which has the data servers, I suppose, and also to fund training workshops and, you know, promotional stuff like t-shirts and leaflets telling people what people do. So they do employ people as well. Yeah, they have job adverts for coders. And it's, as far as I know, I may be wrong because I'm not well up on the funding, but I think it's all just funded by donations.
What are your role in
the Wikipedia? I'm an editor. I've been editing for a few years now, probably two or three. I joined up ages ago, didn't do anything for a couple of years, and then I corrected a few typos, and then it sort of, you know, I became a bit more interested in editing and doing a few RISC OS things, and then I've got a bit sidetracked and found there are other areas where I'm interested in editing. But I'm not a member of Wikimedia. You can actually join that's sort of a donation as well, and then you get newsletters, and then it's a small fee a year, so, you know, I could join Wikimedia. I'm not an administrator. that's quite a torturous process to go through, but people who are administrators, they're involved in the cleaning up. You can clean it without administrators' rights. There's obviously a backlog of things to be dealt with, articles with which aren't in a neutral point of view, or the copyright violations. Any editor can do that, but if it involves deleting something or looking at some material which has been deleted, then an administrator would have to do that. So there have been a couple of RISC OS related articles which were deleted in the past, and files which you can put in an undeletion request, which I've done. The RISC OS Limited article had been deleted, that's now been undeleted. It hasn't been greatly improved, but I've added some citations there and some screenshots which were previously deleted. They've been undeleted as well, so this is the sort of thing that administrators get involved in as well.
So you would have to know quite a lot about the subject you're writing about.
Yeah, it obviously helps, yeah. but related to that, if there is a deletion discussion, the decision on the deletion isn't always based on information by people who know a lot about the subject, which is why it also boils down to the sources. If there are sources and it's discussed in various publications elsewhere, then other editors who don't know anything about it, they can say, well, I know nothing about this, but look, it's been talked about here by this person. This person's talked about it. It warrants an article. So you don't necessarily have to know a lot to contribute to put your opinion forth as to whether something is a worthy subject, which seems a bit strange, but I don't think the encyclopedia would work otherwise, because there would just be too many articles, I think, for people to have enough in-depth knowledge. It's not ideal, but you know, that's how it is, and you know, maybe the process will evolve to something different in the future. Yeah.
So how do you check the original sources are correct?
The easiest thing is if there's a link to them, if they're online, that's great. Obviously you can just go, as long as the link isn't dead. If they're not online, it's obviously more difficult, and this is something we have got to address within the RISC OS sort of area, because a lot of the magazines aren't available online. If the sources have been included, and you can see who's included what by an editor who is sort of trustworthy, if you can look at their edits and say, oh, okay, well, I believe this person is editing sensibly, then you know, you just take the word for it. I added some sources to an article which was to be deleted, and no one else could check them, and I said, well, I can offer a scan of them, and they kind of looked at my editing history, and they believe me. But yeah, I mean, there is scope for people allegedly citing a source and there being no such source there, and that's a problem as well. But you've got to look at the greater picture. There's a wealth of free knowledge there, but it does have to be taken, as your students sort of appreciate, with a pinch of salt, really. And then, like I say, Yui, I want to wrap it up soon, because I don't want to keep you from the main sort of theatre. So if there are any final sort of questions, and then we'll finish. Okay? Well, please come out to the stand, have a chat with me, sign up for a free account. I think I've got some badges and some stickers if anyone's interested. Thank you very much, and have a good show.
Thank you.
Thank you.